I spent a lot of years covering New Jersey politics from my home here in Hoboken. This town feeds one of my other passions, great food. I've always been fascinated by political deals and cooking great meals. So I figured, why not combine them?
Funding for Pasta and Politics with Nick Acacella provided by Gibbons PC, with 220 attorneys in New Jersey, New York, Pennsylvania, and Delaware. O'Toole, Fernandez, Weiner, Van Loo, LLC, attorneys at law. NJM Insurance Group, grown in the Garden State, and proudly serving New Jersey's businesses and citizens for more than 100 years. Fairview Insurance Agency, a family-owned and operated insurance agency with locations in Verona and Cherry Hill. And by the Flemington Car and Truck Country family of dealerships, now in their 39th year. Family, not corporate.
Today I'm talking pasta and politics with Tom Kane. Kane won a close election to become New Jersey's governor in 1981 and then won again in 1985 with one of the largest margins ever. Before that, he served in the Assembly and became Assembly Speaker while in the minority party. He's also become a national figure as chairman of the 9/11 Commission. We'll talk about everything, from food.
Garlic is one of my favorites.
Well, maybe we'll throw a little more in there.
To how we run campaigns today.
Now in the Buckley decision, they said money is free speech. Thomas Jefferson must be rotating in his grave.
So let's get cooking.
Governor Tom Kane, welcome to Pasta and Politics with Nick Acacella. Thank you for coming today. The governor has asked us to do something with seafood. We're going to do a thin spaghetti and with the scallops sautéed in olive oil. But we'll get to that. First, we want to talk a little bit about politics.
But I can't wait for the food.
I don't blame you. I don't blame you. You got your political career started. You ran for the Assembly in 1967. You must have been... Were you old enough to vote?
Just. And I'd never been to Trenton.
You'd never been
never
to Trenton?
Been to Trenton. No.
Oh, because your dad was
I wasn't planning a run. They had a primary. And all of a sudden, the whole organization got challenged. And so they couldn't find enough candidates. And the county chairman called me and said, I got a district. It's a tough district, Irvington and so on, for Republican.
Sure.
He said, but why don't you do it? And I thought about it. And I was doing the graduate school then. And I thought, well.
You were in graduate school.
Yeah, I thought, what have I got to lose?
A couple of years later, in 1972, I believe, you became speaker. There's a great story behind your becoming speaker.
Yeah.
I mean, you did it, the only time I know of this happening, when your party was in the minority.
Yes, that's right.
How'd you pull that one off?
The Democrats had a huge split. They really didn't get along with each other. The Hudson delegation, Mercer delegation were like that. And they were fighting as to who would be the Democratic leader. And they throw out the old leader, who was David Friedland from Hudson County. He'd been the leader for the last 4 years. And I was the majority leader when he was the Democratic leader before. And we had some fun. I mean, he introduced a bill, you know, to turn the Statue of Liberty around because Hudson County was tired of seeing its rear end.
Right. I remember that.
Well, the Friedland people came to me, and we had about three Democratic chairmen, and said, we just don't want to let this other group win, and we'd rather have you. So I said, how many votes have you got for me? And he says, as many as you need. So
that's amazing. Yeah. I mean, I don't think that's ever happened before or since.
Well, up to that point, this is not like it is now. Leadership used to rotate every year.
Yes, that's true.
And
that's true.
So I was 1 year assistant majority leader, or next year majority leader, and that year was speaker. But the next year, they reelected me unanimously.
77, you ran for governor in the Republican primary and did not win.
That's right.
But in 81, you did win, but by the slimmest majority in history, I believe 1,797 votes. For full disclosure here, Governor, I was the guy on the desk for the networks tabulating the vote that night. Where were you that night when you found out? Was there a moment when you thought you had lost?
Oh, yes. I was sure I'd lost the last 2 weeks.
Oh, really?
There wasn't a single poll between the time I declared in the primary to election day that showed me ahead.
Not a one.
Not a single one. Now, I knew I was coming up, and I knew it was getting closer, but I was 30 points behind when we started.
We started
coming up, and I didn't think I'd made it. And that night, two of the networks, at 7 o'clock, said, not only has Kane not won, but Florida is going to win by a good majority.
Mm-hmm.
So I drove to headquarters, On the back of an envelope, I was scribbling a concession statement. I got to the headquarters. My campaign manager, who was Roger Bodman, said, whoa, let's wait a minute. We got some unusual returns coming in from Democratic areas, and you're running better than we think over there.
You ran much better in some Democratic areas
so
than anybody anticipated.
Yeah, let's just not concede just yet. And it was a long,
it
long
It was a couple
night.
Of weeks.
Oh, yeah, it was a couple of weeks.
So I worked for two straight weeks, collecting all of the errata of that election.
And what I found out about recounts is that they very seldom change the results.
Yeah.
You can have 30,000 mm-hmm. votes that are wrong, mistakes.
That's absolutely true.
But the mistakes come even out.
They even out. So here you are, Governor, with the overwhelming mandate of 1,797
right.
votes. You face a Democratic majority in both the Assembly and the Senate, and had to deal with some real characters. I mean, Carmen Areccio was the Senate president. Chris Jackman of my home county of Hudson was the speaker. How did you deal with these guys? Because they were characters.
One of the great advantages I had, and it's a real advantage for anybody running for governor, I'd been in the legislature for 10 years.
Right.
And in those days, I think people were a little friendlier, Democrats and Republicans.
Governor, let's turn to the serious part of the program. Let's do some cooking.
Great.
We're going to take a couple of cloves of garlic. And we're going to squeeze them.
Yeah, squeeze them. What do you mean squeeze them?
We're going to squeeze them with the knife.
Oh, with the knife?
Yeah.
Okay.
That makes the skin come off. I don't know if you've ever chopped garlic before, but that's what I'm going to ask you to do while I put some...
First time.
First time? Well,
yep.
There we go. Here we go. People are going to be very, very happy with you in the future.
Yeah.
We're going to make a cook out of you.
Most people don't even let me have a knife.
Yeah. I'll show you how. What we want to do is get it as fine as possible and kind of just up and down. Go to it.
Like this?
Up and down.
Okay.
That's beautiful.
That's good. Well, they're getting smaller.
I don't know how you feel about garlic. I love it, but I tend to over-garlic things.
Garlic is one of my favorites.
Well, maybe we'll throw a little more in there. That's perfect. Just get it on the knife, throw it in there. You were reelected in 1985 in the exact opposite kind of election from the first one. I think you carried all but three municipalities in the state.
It's the largest victory of anybody in history of the state. I carried 60% of the African-American vote.
Did you? Did you?
And no Republican before or since in recent history has done that in any state.
Nobody's come close.
And I was very proud of that and proud of the African-Americans, frankly, around the state who supported me. I mean, Coretta Scott Ken came in and campaigned for
me. Did she really?
Actually, Senator Kennedy, called and said, Coretta, he's a Republican. You really shouldn't be doing that. And she said, I told him Martin would have. And then he shut up.
That's nice.
I was very proud of having that.
Well, my favorite story from any of your campaigns was the beer in Bayonne story. You have to tell that.
One of my opponents called Bo Sullivan, who was a nice guy from my county in Essex, and had a lot of money. And Bo decided he was a good old Irishman, and I was not friendly with everybody, and I was sort of above everybody. I was an academic or what have you. And so he put an ad out saying he's not the kind of guy who would have a beer with you in Bayonne.
Right.
And they asked me about it. I said, well, I'll tell you what. I'll buy him a beer in Bayonne after I beat him in this primary.
Priceless.
And he did, by the way. When I beat him in the primary.
I was just going to ask you,
We went to the bar in Bayonne and had a big field with the television cameras. And,
worked to your advantage.
It worked to my advantage.
The next ingredient, Italian parsley. This is easier to chop. If you do this, but get the stems out of there.
Okay.
And I would brown this.
No stems.
No stems. The scallops, we have washed them, dried them in a towel. When the scallops go in, the pasta goes in, and both take about 6 to 7 minutes.
Okay.
You were noted for what you called the politics of inclusion. Can you explain what you meant by that?
It's about everybody. And everybody, and what your beliefs are, you can be right wing, left wing. If you really want to do what's best for the state, often you can compromise around something and get it done. It doesn't matter if you're black or you're white or you're Italian or you're Irish. We all should come together.
That's another thing that's
and politics ought to really be about everybody, and everybody ought to have a place in it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think politics these days, they practice what I call a politics of division, because they find ways to separate one person from another in order to get their votes.
You've lived through the arc of New Jersey politics now, 40 years. How has it changed?
It's changed a lot. Now the danger someone like me has, you know, it's very easy for us old guys to say, look how wonderful it was in those days. And that we shouldn't do. But it was better.
It was better.
That said,
yeah,
yes.
Yeah, that said, it was better. And better in these ways. We got along a lot better. I mean, Brendan Boone and I first became close friends. Brendan's one of my closest friends.
Yes.
Brendan and I became
yes.
friends when I was a Republican leader in the legislature, and he was a Democratic governor. I mentioned Chris Jackman, Carmen Arecchio. He and I came from Essex County together. His whole family were friends of mine. I know the whole Arecchio
family. Of course,
family.
you were both
yes.
Essex County
yeah.
guys.
And we were
of
old
course.
Friends. And you know, they'd come into the office and sit down, and we honestly were starting to say, "Or I won't have this position, you have that position. How can we get this done? And how many votes can we get from both parties to get it done?" And the bottom line was, what's better for New Jersey? And you had that kind of legislator who may be conservative, maybe liberal, but on certain issues that were very important to the state, they would come and they'd vote their conscience. And that was permissible. And let's see if we can get that thing
that
done.
That seems to be harder to do these
I think
days.
It is now. Yeah. I don't think it happens that much. People get punished
does.
Now,
yeah.
and it's yeah. a disease that comes from Washington.
In Washington, yeah. it's viral.
Yeah, it is.
It's just
awful.
And poisonous.
Absolutely
yeah.
awful. And it's spreading a bit to New Jersey. And the other thing is money.
Money.
I mean, money yeah. is awful now in politics. It's a cancer on the whole system.
I couldn't agree more.
Yeah, we didn't have that. I mean, the first time I ran for the Assembly, it cost me $3,700.
I think that's the maximum contribution now from
yeah,
one
I know.
Person.
I know. Yeah. I raised it on $10, $25, you know.
How do you feel about these tax-exempt organizations, 501c3s and 501c4s, it seems to me they've made it even more complicated and more horrible.
Immensely complicated, and it's bad court decisions. And the really bad decision was the so-called Buckley decision
the
in the
70s. Buckley, yeah.
Because
yeah.
up to then, you had government regulating how much you could spend out of your own pocket, too. These rich guys couldn't spend all their money either. There's regulation right. on what you could spend. So it was sort of even. Now, in the Buckley decision, they said money is free speech.
Right.
And Thomas Jefferson must be rotating
his
must grave.
Be.
but I just don't.
I've never understood that
no,
argument.
I
money is
either.
Not speech. Money's
but,
money.
But once the court said that, then the rest of the decisions, like the last one, just built
sure.
on that first decision.
Sure. That was the foundation.
Yeah. But that's the cancer. I mean, if you got rid of that, I think we'd have a political system that was a lot fairer, a lot
better.
Can
you ever go back?
Not without either a constitutional amendment yeah. or changing the court. With the way we have it now, I think the very best we can hope for is disclosure.
Right.
As long as people
right.
are spending, at least we
I
should know who the hell it is.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, who's putting the
that's
money
right.
in there?
Who's
at least tell me.
Yeah. yeah, and then you know afterwards when somebody's elected yeah. and they vote in some way that doesn't seem quite right.
Right.
You know if they got right. a huge contribution
right.
from somebody. And the public,
right.
we deserve to know that. The public deserves to know it in a democracy. Otherwise, the democracy doesn't work very well.
Let's throw this.
Okay.
We're gonna save a little sprinkle on top. Let's
right.
throw that in.
All right.
It's gonna sizzle around.
Yeah.
And here comes the good part. We're gonna throw the pasta in there, the scallops in there, and we're gonna let them go for about 6 minutes. I love scallops. You know why? No calories.
And don't they really?
No calories at all.
I mean,
lots of protein.
I love something that's not fattening.
Yeah, love
that's
protein.
That's good.
Why did you never run for anything else again?
I guess that party asked me 5 or 6 times to run for Senate.
Yeah, oh yeah. Your
and
name constantly was coming
I
up.
Just, I looked at the Congress and I just thought I'd get frustrated. You know, it's a dull different job.
It's
when you're governor, you can administrate, you can get every single
yeah.
day I went
yeah.
home, and maybe it's something for one individual, something I'd gotten done.
There are legislative personalities and executive
yeah.
personalities.
Yeah.
There really are.
And I think it would have been different if the Congress worked a different way. The seniority system. I would have to wait 10 years
yes.
before I even came close to anything.
I say this to everybody who runs yeah. for Congress. I said, what are you doing?
Exactly.
I mean,
right.
it's going to be 10 years before they let you yeah. speak.
I didn't think I'd had patience.
Oh, okay. Fair enough.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Fair
yeah.
enough. If you had to pick one accomplishment that you look back on and say, that was really satisfying, whether it was because of the magnitude of the thing or because of the difficulty in getting it done.
I think maybe cleaning up the shore.
Okay.
We had
yeah.
terrible pollution
yeah.
on the shore.
Yeah.
Needles from New York,
yeah,
hospital waste, all
I
of
remember.
That. And we spent $750 million.
Really?
Yeah. It was one of the largest expenditures in the state
'80s.
History. Yeah.
$750 million was real money.
That's right. It was real money. And we had to clean up all the runoff from the towns to change their sewerage systems. We had to sue New York and get them to stop dumping stuff. We had to close a landfill on Staten Island. But by the time we finished, we had the cleanest ocean and the cleanest anywhere down the whole shore, and we could prove it.
What was the biggest crisis you faced as governor?
I had a crisis right off the bat. After I'd only been in a few years. They found one of the most difficult, something called dioxin. Dioxin had been at Times Beach, Missouri, poisonous substance that they'd closed, cleaned out the whole town for, to get rid of dioxin. I was approached one day by my health commissioner and my head of the environmental affairs. And he said, "We got a big problem." I said, "What?" "We found dioxin in Newark."
What caused it? Where was it from?
It was an old factory that had been there years ago. Actually, dioxin, unless it's blowing around, is not a problem. Mm-hmm. And like a lot of chemicals, we found out that, you know, if you'd handled it right, it wasn't that much of a problem. We didn't know that then. All we knew this was terribly toxic, and it was in the streets. So we called in all the departments, got them together. And then I got a rumor that the Ledger had the story. It was about to print it. So I called Mort Pye, who was editor of the Ledger, and said, "I've never asked you to do this before. I'll never ask you again, I don't think. But I think you've got a story, and I don't want you to run it because we're not ready yet."
Really?
"And we will cause panic if you run that story before we've got the health people on the streets and all the people talking to the community." And I'd met with the mayor and the council, all that. And I said, "We're doing that. It'll take me 24 hours. He hesitated for a minute and said, "You know, I don't think we've got that story quite right yet. It may take us a little more time."
See, that's another thing that doesn't happen anymore.
Yeah. It
can be an adversary relationship without being an antagonistic relationship.
Oh, yeah, sure.
You've told us the cooperation with the press. What got you the most criticism from the press? What was the thing you did that made them come after you?
They didn't come after me. I raised taxes. I tell legislators this, you know, we can't ever touch a tax. I raised the income tax. Mm-hmm. I raised the sales tax. I voted for a gas tax hike. I tried to raise the gas tax. And I got elected by the largest margin in state history.
There you go.
After that.
I think we're ready to toss this pasta. Here we go. We're going to do this all very quickly because we want it hot. Put it here. It's a nice thin spaghetti.
And it goes right in.
Uh-huh. Just goes right on top there.
Looks great.
Add a little salt. Mm. Add a little pepper. Mm. We've got lots of color in there, but we'll throw a little bit more on there. And in a minute, we'll sit down and we'll eat a bit.
It looks terrific.
Thank you. Governor, this is the last part of our time together. I want to share some of what we have cooked here together.
Good. I'd be pretty mad if you didn't. After all this. Thank you.
Thank you for joining us.
Mm. Thank you for having
me. We have here a fine New Jersey Pinot Grigio.
Nothing like good New Jersey stuff.
Nothing like good New Jersey stuff. And I want to talk to you about the most recent phase of your public career because it fascinates me. President Bush appointed you the head of the 9/11 Commission. How did that appointment come about? I know Henry Kissinger was first named and he had to withdraw. How did that come about?
Surprised me. I was sitting at home one night and phone rang and it was Karl Rove. I don't really know Karl Rove very well. And he said, "Would you be interested in being one of the people considered?" And I thought for a minute and said, "Yeah," thinking, you know, they're looking at 20 people and they're probably not gonna pick me. I didn't know Bush that well. I knew his father, but not him that well. And so, fine, went to bed. Next morning, the phone rings, and it is his chief of staff. And he said, "Would you do the president a great favor? Would you accept the position?"
Really?
Yeah. And he said, "The president will call you tomorrow." So I thought for a second and said, "Yes." And then I went out and told my wife, I said, "I think a ton of bricks just fell on me." I just couldn't.
You accepted on the spot.
On
you
the
didn't
spot.
Say, "Give me 24 hours. Give me."
No, you know, it's very hard to do that when the President of the United States asks you to do something.
Fair enough.
Yeah, it really is. And particularly, I was the only commissioner actually lived right in the middle of the area. That's one of the people that reasonably probably would have selected me. But But I knew, I mean, I went to funerals for 5 weeks or 6 weeks or 7 weeks after it happened, and I talked at the memorial service, and I was really knew a lot of the families, so it would have been very difficult for me to say no. Very difficult.
You had as your co-chairman Lee Hamilton, the former congressman from Indiana, is that right?
Yeah, he was actually the vice chair.
Did you know him before?
No, not really.
Not at all.
I knew him by reputation, mm-hmm. which is wonderful. Yeah. I mean, everybody liked Lee Hamilton, and I was delighted. In fact, Lee and I have talked. You know, he was a second choice, too.
Oh, I didn't know that.
George Mitchell was the choice.
Oh.
And George Mitchell withdrew for the same reason Kissinger did. Mm-hmm. George Mitchell withdrew because he said, I've got clients, and I can't reveal their names.
And Mitchell would be in the same situation.
Yeah, so they both withdrew. And so Lee and I always referred to ourselves as the second choices.
The second team, yeah, right. It worked out pretty well. Out of the recommendations that the commission made, what has been done and what has been left undone?
Well, people are much safer because a lot of the recommendations have been done.
Yeah.
For instance, you know, one of the reasons it happened was the intelligence agencies weren't talking to each other. We put in a mechanism under the Director of National Intelligence, under the task force now, where they have to talk to each other. So it's not perfect yet, but it's a lot better. Another 9/11 could not happen the same way because they share information. And there's a number of other good accomplishments. There's one big one that's not done. And it's the biggest irritation I have right now. When we did our report, the Homeland Security Department, we found reported to 84 different congressional committees. 84.
Right, that's insane.
And so that's no oversight at all.
That's insane.
And nobody had real authority over them. And so...
if everybody's in charge, nobody's in charge.
So we recommended change the committees. It's now 10 years since we made our report. You know what the situation is now? 94 committees.
If you leave legislatures to their own devices, that's exactly what's going
now,
to happen.
Every single director of Homeland Security, two Republicans now and two Democrats, have called me or sat with me or had lunch with me and said, can't you do something about it? Because we're spending one third of our time testifying before Congress instead of protecting the American people.
That report was excellently written, by the way.
Thank you.
There were portions of this that read like a novel. It was really very, very good.
You know, the amazing thing to me was we all wrote it. But remember, this was an election year.
Right.
And
that's right.
On the Democratic side, they thought the commission was going to whitewash Bush. On the Republican side, they thought the commission was going to implicate Bush.
Mm-hmm.
And it could cost the election. So when I first arrived at the commission, the Democrats were all sitting on one side.
Oh.
And the Republicans were all sitting on the other. And I'm all school teachers. The first thing I said to them, look, we're going to have the meeting now. I don't want to see any Democrat sitting next to a Democrat. I don't want to see any Republicans next to a Republican. And they looked at me like, who the hell is this guy from New Jersey? But I started off that way. And then, because I was a new guy in town, nobody really knew the guy from New Jersey. All the rest were Washingtonians, pretty much. And so 60 Minutes called and said, we'd like you to lead our show next Sunday. And I said, fine, I'd be happy to do it. I want you to invite Lee Hamilton with me. The guy who ran the show said, we don't allow our guests to pick guests. And I said, fine, get somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
That lasted about 5 minutes and the phone rang again. You and Congressman Hamilton would be more than welcome.
Yeah, right.
And then we couldn't tell him. We asked the other commissioners, said, this is what Lee and I are doing. So if you get asked to appear on television or radio, would you ask somebody from the other party to come with you? And it not only helped because we always had a Republican and a Democrat together, but it also helped because the commissioners started to get to know one another. And I remember the first time we had a dinner, and Lee Hamilton said, what the hell are we having a dinner for? And I said, don't worry about it, Lee. I just think it's important to have a dinner. He realized finally that at the dinners, people started swapping old political stories.
Yeah.
We stopped being Republicans and Democrats.
Right.
We didn't know each other.
Being colleagues.
Well, you asked me before, what are the difference in the legislature? We used to have dinner every night on the way home. And it didn't matter what party you were in, you know, you joined the big table and you talked.
Also, from what I've been told of those days, you could yell at each other on the floor and then over dinner.
Oh, yeah.
That's
when
Absolutely.
We were all friends and it stayed that way. You know, the most obstreperous legislature I was ever in, the most difficult, was the income tax. Because that was the toughest issue facing any legislator, whether to establish a state income tax. And people felt so strongly about it. We became good friends in the process. We still get together once or twice a year.
Do you really?
Yes. We get together in New Brunswick once every couple of years, and we break bread together. See? We talk about old times.
It works.
Because we're good friends. It works. It works. And that's the way it should be. That's the way politics should be. It works better that way.
Well, we talked about a lot of things. You've enlightened me. You've entertained me. But my Aunt Josephine, when people talk a lot, she has a saying. When there's food on the table, in Italian, it's mangia e sta zitta, which means let's shut up and eat. So, thanks for joining me.
Thank you, sir.
Funding for Pasta and Politics with Nick Acacella provided by Gibbons PC, with 220 attorneys in New Jersey, New York, Pennsylvania, and Delaware. O'Toole, Fernandez, Weiner, Van Loo, LLC, attorneys at law. NJM Insurance Group, grown in the Garden State, and proudly serving New Jersey's businesses and citizens for more than 100 years. Fairview Insurance Agency, a family-owned and operated insurance agency with locations in Verona and Cherry Hill. And by the Flemington Car and Truck Country family of dealerships, now in their 39th year. Family, not corporate.